color scholars and organizers, and they'll be sharing their work documenting personal, local, and global stories of the diaspora. My name is May. I'm the fifth generation owner of Wing on Woe, as well as the founder and director of the WOW Project. This event is sponsored by the Asian Pacific American Institute at NYU and the WOW Project as well, which is a community initiative that is amplifying community voices and stories through art, activism, and culture in a time of rapid cultural displacement in Chinatown. So without further ado, I want to introduce our four amazing panelists. Please do bear with me as I read their very accomplished bios. So we have on my left, Nissa Chow is a writer, new media storyteller, and educator. Nissa is an alum of both Columbia's MFA program and Oral History Masters of the Arts program, and currently a core member of the program's faculty. Her thesis, Intersecting Histories, The Story of Her Skin, won the 2017 Jeffrey H. Brodsky Oral History Award. She was awarded the 2018 Penn Jean Stein Grant for Literary Oral History, which recognizes a literary work of nonfiction that uses oral history for still life. Nissa was also a recipient of the Hollywood Foreign Press Award, the Woman in Film and Television Fellowship, the Toms Fellowship, and the Academy of Motion Pictures Foundation Award. She was the recipient of a Sloan Foundation grant, and in 2014, she won the Zaki Gordon Award for Excellence in Screenwriting. Her nonfiction essay, How to Become a Monster, was published in the spring 2018 issue of Plowshares. Next to her is Tao Goff. She was born in London and raised between the UK and US. Tao is a cultural critic specializing in the narratives that emerge from histories of imperialism, migration, and globalization. Tao's interdisciplinary research examines the unfolding relationship between technology, the senses, memory, and nature. Tao has held academic positions at New York University, Princeton University, and Hunter College, CUNY. She received her PhD from Yale University and bachelor's degree from Princeton University. In 2019, she will begin a joint position as assistant professor in the Department of Africana Studies and the program in Feminist, Gender, and Sexuality Studies at Cornell University. Next to her is Huiying Bernice Chan, who is a creative writer, multimedia storyteller, and aspiring healer with roots in Chinatown and the Toisanese diaspora. Huiying received the 2016-2017 NAFL Fellowship to travel solo to Chinatowns in 8 countries around the world to document global migration and resilience across the diaspora. As a current Open City Fellow with the Asian American Writers Workshop, Huiying is covering stories of intergenerational arts and activism in Chinatown. Their writing has recently been published in Culture Push's Push-Pull Online Journal, the Blue Shift Journal, and the Asian American Journal of Psychology. Huiying is continuing to dream a life that is oceanic. And finally, we have Diane Wong, who is a doctoral candidate at Cornell University, where she writes on race, gender, and the gentrification of Chinatowns. As a writer, educator, and multimedia storyteller, her research stems from a place of revolutionary praxis and deep love for community. Her current research explores how gentrification-led displacement politically impacts the Chinese immigrant communities in New York City, San Francisco, and Boston. Her research has been funded by the National Science Foundation, Mellon Foundation, American Political Science Association, and Smithsonian Asian Pacific American Center. And it has appeared in a variety of publications, journals, anthologies, and podcasts. Diane is currently a visiting scholar at the Asian Pacific American Institute at New York University, where she is finishing her dissertation and working closely with the WOW Project and Chinatown Art Brigade. All right, so obviously have amazing panelists tonight. The format of the panel this evening will be 1 hour of conversation between the panelists, followed by a 30-minute Q&A with the audience. So prior to tonight's discussion, I asked all of the panelists to prepare a question for the other panelists that are here. So they'll actually be asking each other questions on this panel, and I'm kind of going to be the facilitator of the discussion. So to kind of kick off the conversation, I'm going to ask one of the questions that Nissa actually wanted to ask all of the panelists. And that is about the relationship of these projects and research topics and their roots to identity. So how you focus your research and analysis on what you call Afro-Asian intimacies in the Americas. Nissa, you tell stories that about your family and roots in Trinidad. Diane, your dissertation research looks at the political impacts displacement has and continues to have on Chinese immigrant communities across the U.S. And Huang, your research and writing documents global migration and resilience across the Chinese diaspora. So I want to ask if you could talk first briefly to introduce the focus of your research and or your project, and also talk about what questions began these investigations. So if we want to start maybe with Diane, and then we'll come this way to Nissa, and then after I'll invite one of you to ask another panelist a question.
Thank you, May, for that introduction. Did you introduce yourself?
Yeah, I did. It's not about me.
So a lot of my work looks at sort of the political impacts and implications of displacement on the Chinese diaspora, and a lot of that stems from my own family experiences of movement and dislocation. So I'm first-generation Chinese-American here, but my grandmother and my mom, they're from Shanghai, China. And when they were growing up, you know, they lived in a, I don't know how to say it in English, a long song, like alley, it's sort of like an alleyway, but it's like a neighborhood, I would say. And it's sort of outside of the main streets, but it's very communal. And so it was in the 80s where the government essentially sort of decided to pursue a lot of urban renewal development policies, and their homes were essentially uprooted. They were uprooted from their homes and moved to a place that they just were never familiar with. And so I'm really interested in looking at sort of the political impacts of movement on people and on everyday lives. And it's beyond just thinking about politics in the electoral realm, but thinking about it more broadly in terms of how it manifests in people's everyday lives and how you live politics. And so that's sort of what got me interested in politics, and so I decided to become a political science major when I was an undergrad at Binghamton. And it was there that I really grappled with questions of, you know, diaspora from a broader Asian American context, and I began to take Asian American Studies courses with one of my mentors, Lisa Yun, and she wrote a book called Cooley Speaks, which sort of traces, okay, shout out to Lisa. So she wrote a book called Cooley Speaks, which traces sort of the parallels of the African slave trade with the Chinese coolies, labor migrant workers in Peru and Cuba. And that really got me thinking about movement and sort of what it takes for communities to plant roots, and what then that means to stay, and what the consequences of being uprooted from your home that you built are. And so after that, I did a quick, I worked with MoCA for a couple of months to put together a walking tour post 9/11 in Chinatown. And that's when I really realized that, you know, things were changing in the neighborhood. That's when a lot of the development that you see, the gentrification that you see, really crept into the neighborhood. And so that's when I realized, you know, that displacement shapes political identities and people's identities. And so that's sort of what conceptualizes a lot of the work that I do. And, you know, a lot of the work that I do with the Bob Project, building these oral histories, the work that I do with Chinatown Art Brigade, right, is to really collect these stories and to really explore identity in a more multifaceted way.
Okay, thank you. Okay, yeah. So the project that I did for 1 year was traveling to Chinatowns in 8 countries around the world, and it was funded by where I had gone to undergrad, like post-graduation. And it was an entirely self-designed project on a research topic of my own choosing. And why I chose to go to Chinatowns stems from, I guess, just like everything in my past, and like the questions that I've had about home, like where my family is from and what that home is like. And so for me, like, I ended up collecting oral histories in
countries, I'll name them really quickly. It's Peru, Cuba, South Africa. I went back to China, to Toi San, where my family is from. And I also went to Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, and Australia. And I was in the capital cities of each of those countries for the most part. But to backtrack a little, like, why I do oral histories comes from when I was really young. In fifth grade, my elementary school teacher asked us to ask our parents about like where they came from and to conduct like a mini oral history. And so I had all these standard questions that she gave us, like what was your childhood like, and things like that, and I asked my mom. And that was the first time that I had heard about like anything from my parents' past, and she was telling me like all of this history about the Cultural Revolution, like Japanese invasions, and like what my grandparents had like grown up in China going through. And so I go back to school and I share this, right? And like all of the fifth graders are sharing what they collected, and everyone else's stories, for the most part, I was with white kids, and they were just talking about how like, oh, my mom grew up in this town, went to high school, eventually met my dad. And then that was like the general trend, and I come out like spilling all of this like really deep like historical stuff. And I don't think that's what my teacher was expecting, but I think like from there it started all of these questions and these paths that I had never heard before had I not gotten this assignment. So for me, like this opportunity to travel around the world, I had all of these questions about where the diaspora has been, but not only like reading about it online, like I wanted to meet these people and kind of like hear their stories and like see what Chinatowns were like. I was driven by this question of does gentrification exist in Chinatowns outside of the U.S. Because they're really connected here in the U.S. So there was that question, or is it like a Western country thing, was what I was asking. And I also took the trip and chose the topic to broaden my understanding of what I learned in Asian American history, like everything about like the coolie trade and all of that I had only heard about in the context of America. But what I learned was that it was really global and that all of these histories of all of these countries are connected. So that's like a little bit about myself and the project.
Great. Yeah, thank you, May, for, you know, opening up this conversation tonight. So Chinatown is also really important to my work. So it's really wonderful to be here having this conversation in New York Chinatown. So, as May mentioned, I'm a professor teaching at New York University in the Department of Social and Cultural Analysis. And before I got my PhD, I actually took a class in undergraduate called Chinatown USA. And it was one of the first Asian American studies classes that had been taught at Princeton in maybe a decade. And it was an African American studies class. So it really was confusing to a lot of people, but made perfect sense to me, thinking about this idea of Afro-Asia, and also just the history of ethnic studies and how the two fields relate to each other. So in a way, I feel like I've come full circle in that just this past fall at NYU, I taught a class called Chinatown, Havana, Kingston, New York City. And actually, just this past Friday, I returned from Cuba and from the Chinatown in Havana. So there are so many narratives to be told about the kind of long history of colonialism, which is what I look at in my work. So I started out as a literary scholar, so I'm really excited to kind of grapple with this question of methodology, of oral history, because I'll have to admit that I'm actually not an oral historian, and I actually am interested in thinking about the sensorium and the ways in which we know history in our bodies through the senses. So for me, that's really important in terms of food and what I'm calling a kind of gastropoetics. It's in music, it's in family photography, and it's in our kind of spiritual and mortuary practices. But obviously, it's really important to speak to people who have been through these experiences, and I'm excited to kind of get into the deeper histories of that, as well as my own journey. So my sister, who's actually here in the audience, wrote an article about an experience that we had a couple of years ago going with our mother on a trip to China for the first time and discovering the village where my mother's father grew up, and his sort of, I guess, Afro-Chinese boyhood and his life spent between Kingston in Jamaica and Hong Kong, and how, even though that seems really strange to a lot of people who are not aware of, you know, the Asian diaspora and African diasporas, it actually makes perfect sense when you think about British Empire and this relationship between the end of the African slave trade and the transatlantic slavery, and how at that moment, in order to save the sugar industry, the British decided we're going to now import Asian people, so people from India, people from southern China. So for me, these histories are interlocked and interwoven, and we have to begin at that moment in 1803 with the Trinidad experiment and the sort of machinations of British Empire in order to understand our present and where that's going.
I am the Trinidad experiment. I was thinking, what's the most honest way I can say how I actually came to this project? And I guess it's the fact that it actually started with this feeling that I was living in two bodies, right? One was home and familiar to me, and then one was a foreign country. And that body was the one I occupied here in the United States. When I was at home, it was not at all a fraught space. Like, identity wasn't something I had to reach for, it just was mine. No one was asking me what I was. I was ordinary. It was pretty dull, right? And then I come here, and there was this feeling that I was being taught who I was through the gaze of others, right? Other people were telling me who I was and finding me either strange or belonging or not belonging, and it was almost that I was trying to learn how to live in this foreign thing that I suddenly owned and had to be accountable for, right? So it was that idea of like how my identity here in America was being formed by being watched. And it made me realize I had never really questioned that at home at all. My project ended up being, was wondering what it was like to live in a body like mine and in other bodies in Trinidad during my grandmother's time, when it was fraught to be in that body in a not at all dull way, right? And so the project I end up speaking to people and interviewing people from in very different bodies, trying to understand how their identities were shaped, but then also how the legacy of those identities were passed down from generation to generation, and then more specifically to women, you know, because that's my family's mostly, we're mostly girls, a lot of us. My grandmother married a Chinese man and they had 7 kids, and they all had 1,000 kids. So and I'm one of them. So that's like the shortest version of that, of how that project started, and it ended up getting hijacked from this much larger, bigger vision. I was going to write a very important academic paper about this, and then I talked to my great aunt Scylla, and it just completely changed everything. And I realized that even though I thought I was doing this very brave thing, I was actually very much hiding the real question. Was how do I explain me? Because she was telling me very specifically about my grandmother, and at a certain point in her oral history, she started talking about the child. You know, the child always had questions. The child was always this, and I was the child, right? And she schooled me in my own questions, the very nature of my own inquiry. And so my project became a much more personal narrative, so tracing my own family's questions about how I learned, three generations down, who I was.
I see a lot of similarities between everybody's questions that have led them to these projects and research focuses. I mean, family, questions of self, also looking at generations through legacies of families. Tonight I think we're gonna try to pick apart all of these things, but also how you went through the process of getting to your finished product with your project. So we're going to talk about methods and process, also about how you thought about the audience when you were thinking about crafting this project, but also about positionality and your narratives. I think that's a really important piece. So we're trying to kind of pepper in different practices that you all can can take away from this conversation, thinking about whether or not you have projects that you're thinking about with your family histories or communities, we want to make sure that this is a productive conversation for you too. So acknowledging that you all are listening into this conversation as well. So just keeping all of that in mind, I'm going to kick it off and ask playing if you can ask one of the panelists a question. Everyone is welcome to piggyback off of the answer of the panelist that answers, but I want to just be conscious of time and that we have until around 8:30 to make sure we get to everybody.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it's going to be hard for me to choose. But I'm gonna ask Nissa. from the snippets that I've seen of your oral history work, I think it's really incredible. And I wanted to ask you, how do you commit yourself from the start to the finish of a deep oral history project that's so personal, from doing the interviews to the finished product and like the multimedia displays, and what your process looks like? And like, what gets you through the lows of like self-directed, self-chosen oral history projects?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. well, it helps to enjoy it. That's honestly the truest thing you can say. I love the process. I love the conversations. I love the privilege of listening and hearing people's stories. So that's not hard. That is always fun. The challenge actually is stopping doing them, because then you have to do the you in a silo work of figuring out what you just got, you know, everything you just got. Process-wise, you're exploring, right? You're sort of setting off on this journey, and maybe you think you know where you're going when you first start, but you're thoroughly wrong about that. And then you're getting lost. I think I actually really enjoy getting lost, so that helps too. And like I think that, like I just said, your narrators teach you what you're really looking for. If there's one thing I learned in this process was abandoning my own certainties and allowing myself to be taught what everything is meant to mean and even why it matters. That characterized this whole project. And for me, because I don't work exclusively as a writer or a documentarian, for me the form is always fluid. So the form is responding to what needs to be described by the work. And so for me, my process really is a conversation, I guess, between the stories that I'm being told and then taking on this task. Okay, so how do I then, what does my audience, right, need to know to understand this, and how, what form, would it be a visual or, like you say, a sensory experience in some of my work, it's like that. Is it an immersive experience? Is it writing? Is it words? Will, you know, best give them that knowledge and the experience of knowing what's been shared with me, right? How do I get from the point where I started, meaning knowing not much at all, to what I've been taught to know, to see how I see the world differently? That's really the goal. And I've completely forgotten the the low points. Oh, I call my mom. in this project at Desit, you know, she's taken all the calls where I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing. And that's I think that is an absolutely crucial part of my process, that feeling of like, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm clearly a mess. That's usually when I'm so close, you know. But you are, because it's also when you're the most lost, as you say. Yeah, that's the part where you're falling, where your certainties are just gone. And usually once I do that, and I call people who know me well enough to know, calm down, right? You know, you've been here before, I'm bored with this. then you find something, right? So community, that's the short answer. Yeah.
Does anybody
want to
tag on?
If I could piggyback on that, I mean, because you brought up this, what I've been gesturing to is the sensory. And I was really struck by that in, you know, listening to telling histories in your website and how you, you know, have the recording of the rustling of the banana leaves, of the sound of the ocean, of the firefly, and to kind of imagine, oh, this is what it would have sounded like in this town in 1920. I guess, could you give more, I guess, a sense of texture of how you decided to incorporate that into the written word?
Yeah, it's what it's really, so what I just said before too, is like, what do people need to know to understand, or really how how best to invite them into your space, yeah? And so, yeah, the sensory, that we have that in common. It's immediately situating when you can hear, it'd be best if you can smell, if you can hear sounds that someone might have, you know, might have heard, if you can feel like you're occupying a space that was real in time somewhere. It's very grounding, right? All of a sudden it's present with you. And that's memory is, it doesn't exist in the past, right? Memory is that thing you experience right now when you're doing it now. And like when it's in that oral history space, people are bringing you into that nowness of it, right? Especially when they get lost and they're sort of describing, oh, I remember the tree and I remember that, you know? That's that. I wanted people to occupy that space of memory in the present. And the sensory was the best way to do that. Especially when you're sort of translating across cultures. Sound is, you know, sound has no language in the same way, right? It is everything. Like, it's our language, human experience, a language of experience. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to go ahead and ask
them? Me? Oh, yeah. I really wanted to, actually, for the writers here, I have two questions. But okay, let me start this way. How did by the time you got to the end of your journey, you've learned all of this, right? You started out wanting to know something, you went on this journey and you found something else. How did that inform your creative work differently? How did that change it or even make it evolve? How is it responding to what you now know? Yeah.
Are you asking?
Both of you guys, yeah.
So how does writing impact?
How did what you learn informed you, the way that you were writing or what you were writing about and how you were approaching that, I guess, yeah, writing from that more personal place?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
So for me, I think like what I've been trying to think about is how to do oral histories that's not just the traditional way that I've seen it done.
Mm-hmm.
Like you interview someone, you transcribe it, and then you kind of like present this like text to text.
Mm-hmm.
But I think like being a writer, whatever that means,
mm-hmm.
is incorporating my emotions in it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So like for me, if I, after like meeting so many Chinese Cuban grandmothers who have all of these memories of Chinatown before the Cuban Revolution of 1959, when it was one of the biggest in Latin America, and then seeing it now as like one of the smallest, like I just have so many emotions and feelings from that, because I kind of like saw what a Chinatown looks like when it's like gutted of all of its like primary institutions, right? And so like for me, writing and being a creative writer, I can capture those feelings in words that are outside of the interview. Because the interview happens, but there's only so much that is shared
mm-hmm.
verbally
mm-hmm.
from that interview. And I love thinking about like what you say too about like the sensory parts of it, like the fan that was blowing in the background, because, and just like the scene of like where we were having it, right, that you couldn't hear through the audio. Like I interviewed a grandmother in her home that was just like stacked with like photo albums and just like newspapers and just like things everywhere of like life and like different time periods. The presentation of it and then how I think about it is really tied to like what creative things I can do in my writing of
mm-hmm.
it that like wasn't shared
mm-hmm.
In the audio transcript.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So for me, I've been writing so much, I don't even want to think about writing anymore. I'm wrapping up my dissertation at this moment, so I've been writing almost every single minute of the day. But it's still a process for me. You know, when I finished collecting, so I guess backtracking, me as a writer, I'm also a writer in my discipline in the way that I've been trained as I'm a political scientist. And so with that, I've had to do a lot of unlearning of methods within my own discipline because as social scientists, as political scientists, we're trained to be very objective. And the key is to be able to generalize your findings, right? But for me, it's about the relationships that I'm building on the ground. It's about sort of the long-term commitments that you have with someone. And, you know, I'm very clear in my writing that my work is not objective. In no way, in any form, is it possible for me to really step back. thinking about the oral histories that I'm incorporating into my work. When I started out doing this work, I didn't actually think, I'm not trained as an oral historian either, and I didn't really think I would be using oral histories to really talk about gentrification or displacement, but there is really no other way of understanding politics and the political consequences that, you know, upwardness has on someone without using oral histories, right? It's not the same as surveys, it's not the same as interviews where it's a one conversation, 15 minutes, an hour, and that's it. It's really about building relationships and commitments to someone in a community. And that's why, you know, I've chosen to take up oral histories in my work. And in the process of writing, there's just so much. Like you mentioned, you don't really ever stop. So right now in my desktop, there's just, it's full because there's just so many audio clips, so much material. And it's really difficult as a writer to figure out what you want to incorporate into your writing, in the themes that you're trying to explore. And because, you know, pages are limited, ultimately you're going to have to figure out what to exclude and, you know, what that means to exclude certain parts and what the consequences are of that. So it's been, you know, it's a process. I don't think that the writing process ever gets easier, especially when it comes to dealing with oral histories and conversations that are so nuanced.
And if I could follow up on the question for Huiyang, I mean, as a poet, Huiyang, to follow up on the question for you as a poet, how does what you gestured to as a kind of sense of the oceanic and being a healer perhaps play a role?
Mm-hmm.
Because I sense that, and maybe we'll talk about this, but haunting may be important to each of our inquiries.
Yeah. Oh my god, that's a really big question. That's a great question, and it's so big.
Especially because I was just in Cuba, and I feel like there's a kind of electricity of being in the Barrio Chino. You talk about these grandmothers.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe part of your question was sort of thinking about what do you do with that extra that can't be articulated in the creative.
Yeah. Wow. I would love to hear other people's thoughts on this too. but I think like what I was just thinking about when you said that, about what this work is in terms of healing. For me, the people who I do oral histories with are like, I'm like obsessed with remembering and like trying to capture truths and people's lived experiences before it's like lost. And like for me, like oral histories can do that. And I think like why I'm so interested in that, it's a big like existential life question. But I would say that I think I know that there's so many histories that are pushed to the wayside of like women in rural China or like queer and trans villagers, right? Those are just like from like southern China. You just like never hear those narratives, but it doesn't mean that they're not there. And it's because like certain stories are always prioritized over others, right? And so when I was in Cuba, there's a bunch of like Chinese men I could have interviewed about their experiences being the presidents of associations and like planning all of these big festivals for the Chinese community, but I felt like they already had their spotlights by like virtue of their lives, right? And so like for me, there's all of these Chinese Cuban grandmothers who are now in their like 80s. And they've also like committed their lives to this type of work, right? But they've been barred from leadership in these Chinese associations because they're mixed race or because they're women. And like me interviewing them was the first time they've ever been interviewed. And so I felt that gratitude. Like the gratitude was really mutual, and they were thankful like to be part of this project and to like have a moment where they're, I don't know, where their truths and their family stories were like in this space together and like valued. And for me, that is mutually healing somehow, like historically and also interpersonally.
Mm.
really struck by your I'm hearing this. I'm really struck by your choice of word. They're haunted, because I'm wondering if in some ways we're all sort of haunted by beauty, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like this sense of that. At least I know I carry that. It sounds like you definitely have some sense of who do you feel this duty to when you're doing this work, right? This urgency, as you say. Yeah, I don't know if that's a question so much as a yeah. I'm cheating because we were talking before, so but but yeah. Anyway.
So a really quick question that, you know, I think about often is sort of the stories that I hear that really stick out in when I'm in conversation with someone during a oral history interview or after, and I'm wondering if you've had those experiences and if you've had conversations with people, not necessarily while you were conducting the interview then and there, but that really stuck out to you that you want to share.
You're asking me specifically?
Specific moment where you were like, this changes everything for me, or you know, those moments where it's really hard to capture, but you know, it's even difficult to write about, but has affected you in ways that are really deep.
It's so deeply that I ended up being the thing I wrote about over, you're right, obsessively writing about, and still trying to figure out how to write about. And it was the interview with my great aunt. What struck me about that was the way that she kept describing dignity without naming it, all the ways that she was just really, what I realized what she was doing was the ways that she was describing the reach for it, I suppose, like try or leave, or maybe just even trying to hold on to this sense of dignity in this time when it was in no way guaranteed to someone who looked like her, or even ascribed to someone who looked like her in any automatic way. So there were all these sort of strategies to hold it and keep it and have it. And one that I guess kept repeating over and over again was that she kept referencing how lighter skinned she was. That was one thing. Over and over again, and it always preceded this moment where she would tell me about some indignity, or sometime when she was about to be put down, or right after she just told me about sometime when she was debased in some way, she would just change the subject and sort of said, "But I was beautiful, and I was beautiful, but I was beautiful," right? And it was sort of the poetry, almost like music, right? The chorus line of that kept coming in, and when it came in, was really striking to me. The other thing that she would do is that she would talk about her dresses, and I write about this a lot. She talked about that she would have, they had no money. But whatever little bit of money she had, she would use to buy fabric. And she said, you know, we weren't seamstresses, but we'd sew this thing, we'd sew it well, we sewed carefully these dresses. And they, you know, white fabric, a lot of times it was, you know, least expensive fabric, but it was perfectly pressed and it was perfectly neat. And you just realize that all of this was really just to contain this dignity, right? There's all of this sort of describing these ways that they would find it and hold it and like claim it. The motif of that really struck me, and I've been still trying to find ways to really write what that is. And it was true across a lot of the different interviews, but I won't go into, but I guess because it was she was describing my family, it really struck me how slippery it was, I guess. Yeah.
And I think similarly for me, it's not any particular moment that I guess has colored the work, but I think a similar sense of women's narratives being really important and the way we understand women's lives really informs my work in the way that we all have been talking about. So I did actually conduct a formal oral history for the APA Institute, the Asian Pacific American Institute at New York University. And it was of a woman named Patricia Chin, and she's the co-founder of one of the largest independent reggae record labels in the world called VP Records. So it was interesting to sort of learn her history. She just turned 80 this year and was born to a Chinese mother, an Indo-Jamaican father. and to kind of hear the sort of wounded intimacies of what it meant that her mother's Chinese family rejected them. Because even though we may think, oh, but they're both Asian, there is this conflict in terms of a Chinese idea of purity. But it was just really interesting to sort of learn about mothering and women's work and women's labor and the ways in which that is counted and not counted. So thinking of your question, Diane, it sort of drew up for me the way she talked about being pregnant and working in the shop, maybe a shop not unlike this, and just what it meant that there was no question of, I don't know, maternity leave or anything like this, but that you would be there 12 hours a day, the kids would be in the shop, and this is the kind of work that women do and have done, but it doesn't get counted as a kind of work and a labor, and it's just so taken for granted in ways that really has spurred my focus to be very gendered in terms of thinking about the value of that work and how a lot of times I think these women may be reticent to tell or to their stories or to answer our questions because they don't think it's that important or they don't value their lives as being significant when there's so much like texture and richness, you know, in these grandmother stories.
And like adding off of that, yeah, wow, there's so many connections between everything we're talking about. So one of the places I went to in my year was China, and I went back to the villages that my grandparents are from. I'm first generation born here, so we're not that many generations removed, but I think a lot of the like the stories and that past is removed. And so I went back to Toisan, to the village that my mom's side of the family is from, and their house is still in the village. Nobody lives in it, but it's been like sitting there for like 30 years. And I was able to meet like the village grandmothers who did stay and who never immigrated, while most of like people. Like, a lot of people left the villages of Toisan. And I met grandmothers who knew my grandmother when my grandma was, like, raising my mom and her, like, five kids. Yeah, and so, like, with them, I learned all of this history of my grandma when she was in her 20s, like trying to raise a family while my grandpa was working in another city. And this like completely changed everything about how I think about my relatives and the context in which I know them. So like I only knew my grandmother when she was a grandmother. I only know my parents when they're parents. But there's all of these lives and all of these stories before they became those roles. Yeah, and so it was really significant for me to learn all of that. And then I guess I conducted an oral history with them. I asked them if I could film them talking in their living room. And they thought I was so weird, like with my camera, just like trying to record everything, audio and visually. But yeah, I have like some of those snippets down, like in my archive. Even if I might not see them for like, I don't know, a few years or however long. Yeah, so that was really a significant moment.
What about you?
Yeah.
No question.
I guess there are particular moments that do stand out. But in particular, so when I first started this journey, I was working with CAB's CTU, organizing Asian communities and their Chinatown tenants union. So they do a lot of anti-gentrification work in this Chinatown around displacement, around Know Your Rights campaigns with tenants who live here. And so when I was working with them, every Monday and Thursday, we would basically go to different buildings in Chinatown and door knock to see if tenants had heat, hot water, and the basics. And we meticulously documented in which buildings, you know, people, tenants didn't have these things. And through those conversations, I was able to build relationships with a couple of elderly tenants. And I remember conducting an interview, a oral history interview, with one of the tenants who lived not so far from here, actually. And you know, they were in the process of being evicted, and the eviction process is incredibly long. It could take weeks, months, years. And oftentimes, especially for limited English proficient tenants who are elderly, who don't have the resources, access, and knowledge, it's really scary, right? So I basically saw this tenant and went to housing court with them. They were a couple over the span of a year to really sort of understand the ways in which housing courts are part of this problem, right? Think about interpretation, language justice. And I remember conducting this oral history interview in their apartment building, and you know, and during the interview, you know, we were having a conversation about sort of what brought them to the neighborhood and what makes them want to stay. And I remember, you know, the grandma brought over tangerines, and you know, offered me tangerines and water and also Coke. And to me, that was that really struck me, because they were losing almost everything around them, including their livelihoods and their homes, but they still had so much capacity to give. That's not something that I know how to really write about, or I'm even comfortable writing about, but that's something that really struck me in that moment in time, and that's sort of kept with me since.
Thank you so much for sharing. I feel like all of this is really personal, so I appreciate you being vulnerable with 40+ people in the room. Thanks for letting us listen in. I wanted to talk about this, or wanted you all to talk about this issue of positionality and how you situate yourself in these stories and in these narratives that you're telling, because they are so personal, and because there's so much going on with what's unsaid and what is said. So I just wanted to throw that question out there, whoever is ready to answer.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I can begin, because I mean, I was thinking about, Diane, what you said about, you know, being a social scientist, being trained as a political scientist, and how, I mean, as educators, like, how do we deal with this question of objectivity and seeing oral histories as evidence, and then therefore, what is our role in terms of mediating that? And I guess I just wanted to mention, I guess, three books that are important to me in terms of thinking through all of this and these questions, and thinking about this question of positionality. So the first is Silencing the Past by Michelle Roof Trio. The subtitle is Power and the Production of History, and it's this really beautiful meta-historical text. He's an anthropologist, and he's just thinking about the question of how history is always the story told by the victors, right? So what do we do with that? And then Woman Warrior has also been really significant to my research coming from a literary background, but also thinking about this question of the unreliable narrator, right? And what we do with that. What is a memoir? What is fiction? What is form? And then the final book that I thought I would throw into the mix in terms of what has made me think about my positionality is The Pagoda by Patricia Powell. And it really examines a kind of historical past of Jamaica in the 1860s and the story of a person who is basically forced to run a Chinese grocery shop and to live as a man. And it's a really complicated narrative about non-heteronormative intimacies, and that really informs my work in terms of critiquing all of these different biases, you know, the sort of continental US focus that there tends to be, thinking about non-normative intimacies, as well as, I guess, the multiracial and not just the monoracial, which we were talking about. But again, it sort of has me in the position of thinking of, well, then what are my own biases? If I'm going to critique all of these things, what is my lens that I necessarily have? And it sort of relates to a question that I had on our list of questions about how do we then tell those stories at the same time as acknowledging that it has to necessarily be a biased story? Because we need to exclude things in order to tell the story, right?
Mm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
go. I mean, like I mentioned earlier, right, trained as a political scientist, I've had to unlearn a lot of my methods. And for me, thinking about my own positionality to write objectively comes from a place of privilege. I think when you're able to write a topic as visceral and as personal, like gentrification and displacement and change, to write about it from a distance, I think says a lot about your approach, says a lot about your politics. And for me, my politics and, you know, my academic work are intimately connected. And so, you know, I really am open about the fact that I can't write from this distance that I've been trained to do. And I think that shakes a lot about sort of my own positionality within the discipline, within the field. And that's something I'm still grappling with.
So it does not come naturally to me at all to speak personally about myself, so it was the absolute last thing I wanted to do. And I tried all different ways not to write that way, and they all felt really dishonest, right? I mean, the most obviously, I was writing for my own family. How am I supposed to do that? So, and so, you know, so that was by force, and just because that would be the most honest point of view. There was no way that I was going, the lens that I was interpreting this through was not my own Nissa as, you know, person inside the story. So once I acknowledged that, then I had to acknowledge that the real reason I didn't want to do it is because I would have to be vulnerable about, you know, why I really wanted to go on this search, right? But it ended up being a really good learning process because I started to think of transparency sort of as ethical practice in a really rigorous way. You know, being really explicit about my investment in this narrative, sounding and being framed in this way gives, you know, a reader, an audience, a way to sort of analyze and sort of locate me and this argument in the context of, like, in relationship to this thing called objectivity, which I don't actually think exists, right? So yeah, so that's the first, that positionality-wise, just being explicit about my position in relationship to what I'm trying to convince you is true. That's the first thing, an ethical practice. In terms of this, in terms of working with oral histories, though, I also, at least for me, I feel like it's, I feel this sense of, again, this duty to make myself, as far as possible, as vulnerable in the text, whatever that form may be, as I'm asking them to do, my narrators to do. And that meant like doing that really difficult interrogative work, right, about my own flaws. I mean, I'm describing them not always in ways that they maybe would want to in front of the world. And so it's only fair that I do the same. So that sort of also decides what position I have in the work. So yeah, so the equal measure. If I'm exposing someone in that way, then I better be there as well. I have done work where I'm not doing that, and so then I feel okay, like my voice can be removed and I don't have to place myself in the center of this narrative because I'm placing them in a different kind of spotlight, you know? But if I'm putting them in glaring lights, I'm gonna stand there too. And that's kind of, I guess, how I think about it in the creative work that I do.
I resonate with a lot of that. I also don't, objectivity doesn't exist. And I think, like, in all of my work, I always stray away from that, like, as far away from that as possible. I think that's what I am. And I think that may also be why I'm not in academia. And that I didn't choose to, like, pursue, I don't know, an academic degree with these oral histories. I want to do something different. And I think, like, my full self came into all of the interviews. And I think that, like, the questions you choose to ask, like, where the interview happens, how you respond to people in the process of interviewing them, how do they feel after, like, do they ever hear from you? Like, this is all, like, all of who you are comes into that, and there's no way to be objective. And so, like, with that is also, like, I think, like, what you said, like, checking your own privilege, or, like, checking your own positionality all the time. And so, like, the work that you do for yourself, in checking all of that, like, manifests in the oral history work that you do. So for me, like, an example of that is when I was in South Africa. I was in Johannesburg, and I was interviewing Chinese South Africans, who were really active in like the Chinese associations there. And so they were telling me this history and these experiences and like what they thought, but like inherent in some of those stories was like racism and anti-blackness. But it was being presented as their truth. Like, this is what they thought because of their experiences, right? And so, like, me as a person doing this and having analyzed, like, I don't know, anti-blackness in monoracial Asian communities, like, I had to kind of, like, put that analysis, like, in there. And then, so when I tell a story of what they told me, it's gonna be different than what they told me as truth. And it's, like, the responsibility and, like, a duty for me to be this person who's collecting it, to like, I don't know, check myself and then check the people in ways like that, in a way that's like, I don't know, somehow respectful of all of everything in the process.
We could all maybe more explicitly talk about audience.
Yeah, perhaps. That'd be great.
Because I know for me, my audience is in part my students, but it's something, you know, being academia or not, that we have to kind of negotiate. So, yeah, I'd love to hear how each of you actually thinks about that. Because as part of my class, Chinatown Havana, Kingston, New York, I assign a digital mapping project where the students map each of the different Chinatowns, and their exploration, one of the groups that was doing the New York Chinatown led them here. So it's really wonderful to actually come full circle and be here and to think about what the stakes are of, yeah, thinking of audience and how we kind of create these personal maps and cartographies.
Because right now I'm in the process of writing this dissertation, and I feel like only 5 people will read it.
Well, yeah, your committee will read your mark.
But my hope is that, I mean, I'm writing because of most intimately my family and sort of what my mother and what my grandmother has had to go through, and a lot of this project really stems from their experiences, and I really have to acknowledge that in my writing. And so I would want to produce something where they can understand, right? Where they can read and feel as though their experiences are validated, that that they know that they've had this influence on my work. I also want, you know, people in my own discipline to read it, to really reshape and rearticulate the ways we think about politics and where it unfolds on the ground in different communities. I would love to have everyone that I've interviewed be part of the process as well. You know, and I think that's been a process as well. I remember one of my favorite discussions that I've had that sort of incorporates my work is the panel that May and I were part of last year, organized by the New York Public Library, where we invited people that we both interviewed to be on the panel to really be in conversation with one another. And so those are the conversations I want to keep having, right, beyond my work, because that only captures part of sort of the oral histories and the work that I've collected. It's sort of taken on its own life.
I think a lot about audience, I guess, because that it's almost the one of the first steps in the process of finding the form, like who's it responding to, who am I in conversation with. So, so just that, and so different iterations of the same material are different because of who it's in conversation with. So, you know, the written piece, when I was thinking about writing it for this context, in American context, I struggled the most with, because I was trying to not embarrass myself in front of people who, you know, from back home, is like, why are you speaking like a grade schooler about our history? To, you know, to, but also needing to ground it in that, and just trying to find that balance was tough. So I leaned more that went home It was much more about the sensory, because it was a multimedia piece, because it was much more about the sensory, because those smells and sounds were familiar. I didn't need words to communicate that. I just wanted them to remember. That's it. So there was that. But I'm going to use this to actually maybe just put this thought out there, because I'm struggling with audience right now because of the time that we're in. I'm struggling with this evolving audience very much. Escalating culture of fear and political fear and all this, content. It seems so much of that. It's almost like the Pied Piper, you know, leading people to seek refuge in everybody else's oppression in this street, in this way. And I'm thinking about this evolving audience. I feel like in a lot of ways, as a maker, you know, all this time I've been thinking of addressing this sort of mildly indifferent audience. It's like they don't really care because they don't know enough to care, but I can convince them to care. But now this evolving audience seems to be deeply invested in, you know, not so great things. It's not an indifference anymore. It's a deep investment in sort of the surveillance of bodies, the, like, you know, the erasure of them, the disappearances of them. And I don't yet know how to respond, because I think so much about responding. To this evolving audience, you know? So I don't know. Feel free to meet me out there to talk to me about that. I have so many questions about it, you know, if you guys have thoughts too, please. Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I have a lot to say. So I think for me, my audience with the Chinatowns project is like, probably like young, emotional, existential Chinese Americans. And like why I say that is like throughout my travels, like it wasn't an easy year. It's like really hard to move from country to country and like not know anyone and then like try to, I don't know, find housing and like live there and figure out everything, like public transportation in other countries, and then like build community in a place you don't have community. And so like what was grounding for me was thinking about people back home here and like all of my friends who are Chinese Americans who would like love to hear about like everything from like the minute day-to-day commute to like the actual content and the stories. And like for me the audience was like people who didn't have the same opportunity to travel around the world, but who these stories would be relevant to. And like since coming back, I've presented my work at like various places, and like academic conferences that I've gone to is not my audience. And like when I was presenting it here at WOW, I would say like that's my audience. Like it was just like a lot of people in diaspora from like, I don't know, all different reasons for coming who were just like connected to this on a really personal level. So that's who I think about in terms of audience. And then I would also say in terms of like everything that's going on, that's really complicated, and also why by the end of the year I got really tired of talking about Chinese people. I don't know, I just like couldn't keep talking. I think I was talking about Chinese people like every day for like a year. It got like really boring. And also like not to generalize about a whole ethnicity, but like In a place like Australia, right, like Chinese immigrants are not the people who are facing like the hardest issues. It's like Aboriginal Indigenous folks, like Black Australians, and so like I was learning about like all of those issues there, and also like thinking about this like Chinese immigrant project, but like the Chinese immigrants there are in a large part contributing to like the colonialism when they don't check like the land that they're on or like involved with, I don't know, indigenous resistance. So by the end I was like, I'm not talking about Chinese people anymore. There's like other things that I have to get to and like learn about. So here, like back in New York now, I would say something similar. There's so much going on in people of color communities that's just like not about the Chinese diaspora and like, I don't know, Chinese people. But there's like connections. I don't know, this is like super general, right? Cause, like, but yeah, I'm thinking about all of that as I continue to think about the work that I want to pursue, which is in a large part why I didn't just like apply to an academic program where I could focus on like Chinatowns around the world. Like that's not, that's not like everything, right? And that's not, I don't know, everything that's happening right now.
Okay, thank you so much. We're gonna open it up to Q&A. I know a lot of you have questions, comments. I'll be moderating and keeping folks to time limit just so we get to everybody's questions. So whoever would like to start. Yeah.
Hello.
Can you maybe say your name?
Yes, I'm Hannah.
And I was wondering, thank you so much for sharing everything. It's really useful. And validating to hear. I was wondering how any of you might juggle the desire to create this like complex and nuanced, or document this complex and nuanced history, while at the same time like acknowledging like perhaps during the conversations like the silences or like the changing topic or conversation, or like when the people you're talking to might not be comfortable speaking about certain things in the setting that you're having a conversation in, because of like either the place of it or like the people nearby, and like whether it's because of like genuine forgetting or trauma. I was wondering how you juggle that.
I mean, it's difficult. It's a difficult process to have, you know, a complete stranger open up to you and to really tell you their story. And for me, especially when working with elderly tenants here, it was a process of relationship building over years, right? It's through showing up to, you know, day-to-day door knocking, to potlucks, to monthly CTU meetings. It's really building a face-to-face relationship that is consistent. And only then, I think, are you really able to have someone be comfortable with you, with the questions that you ask, and in the places that they choose. So I think it's really about relationship building. And there have been times where, you know, there are some questions that are really traumatic or difficult for someone to answer. And for me, I recognize that. And so when I do recognize it, I sort of just move on. But when I don't, and then I realize it later on, I sort of, you know, I it's difficult talking about trauma, especially with someone that you're not familiar with. So for me, I usually don't really interrogate any further until we build like a further relationship.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I would just to jump off of that, I would say, you know, in the space of the interview, I usually would approach it this way. I don't think of it as an interview at all. I'll banish this word. You know, I think of it as opening a space, sort of, you know, creating a space that someone can fill with their story in this way. And you approach it this way. And in my prep with them, I tell them that, I was like, I'm here for as long as you want. I'm here to follow you. You're leading. You know, wherever you want to go, you know, that's where we're going to go with this. You know, I'm here to listen in this way. One way to open the conversation I found to be particularly helpful is I say, you know, so, you know, what I want to talk to you basically today, I just want you to tell me what I need to know to understand the person sitting in front of me right now. And when people have so much agency, if you allow it to exist, people have agency to go where they want. Sometimes that does go to a place where they're calling trauma. I find actually it's usually harder to receive it sometimes, you know, not always, but a lot of times it's actually harder to receive it than for the person who decides in that moment they're ready to share it with you, you know? So that's something you have to sort of prepare yourself for in a way. I think people have so much more agency than we sometimes think they do. They don't want to tell you something they're simply not going to, especially when I'm interviewing grandmothers, believe me. They're going to tell me only what they want. Right. But yeah, so that's it. The silences speak volumes too. Don't assume that you haven't heard. Sometimes the silence is the story in ways. The absence is the thing. And maybe you won't even hear what it means until you listen to it again, right? Like I said with my great aunt, she never said, yeah, they really, really looked down on me. She never said that. Mm-hmm. She simply stopped talking and then said, instead of what, my dresses were perfect, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like there, that absence is
mm-hmm.
so telling,
mm-hmm.
if that makes any sense, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love that point about how you're kind of like understanding of like what happened in this interview like evolves
mm-hmm.
and like changes. And I would say that what I've learned, I would say that now, so I'm like obsessed with like documenting my family stories, right? But I can't do it in the traditional way that I've been taught how to do oral histories. And I've tried to. I've been like, Grandma, I'm gonna bring my camera and I wanna interview you about like your past and like what it was like to immigrate here, and she was like, no. I was like, why not, please? And I would say that this is the same for like different family members, because you can't just like expect them to be okay with all of that and like traumatizing people in the process just to like have these stories documented. And so what I've been learning is to put away the camera and just like building the relationships, like what Diane was saying, and how important that is, and how like recently in a walk home with my uncle, like he started sharing about like working in the restaurants in Chinatown, just like randomly on like a random like Tuesday afternoon after the sunset, like just, and I didn't have anything to record it, right? So that's why I write, like creative write, and have been moving away from that like oral history conducting format. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And just like giving people space to share whatever they want at any time, like over the course of life.
Mm-hmm.
I was struck by two things. One is you said there is no objectivity, right? And then you said, I just opened up space for people. And then you repeated it, space.
Mm-hmm.
What I do is I exhibit artists, and I don't often get to do any kind of oral history with these artists. I present them.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to look at them and try to open up a way for our community to see them.
Mm-hmm.
I guess one of the things that has stayed with me in trying to do this for so many years is a line by Vaclav Havel that got published in the New York Times. I think he was here in 92, something like that, when he became the first theater person to get elected to national office. And he said the belief in the West that all knowledge can be turned into objective knowledge. And he said, that belief is dead, and we now have to get subjective.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I guess, means to me, in relation to what you're doing, is that you're calling your, to a certain extent, you're saying academic oral history has a certain objectivity to it. How do you balance those things out?
Mm-hmm.
But you're saying there is no objectivity, and I'm wondering, I have my issues with academia too. That's why I'm into talking directly to the visual artist. And how does objectivity come into this? This to me is opening up the space where people of color really live when you interact with people. And I don't know if we're creating a different reality. not sure how objective, how much it can be objective.
No objectivity. Like, I mean, so, you know, oral oral history is a lie that lie that tells the truth, right? And it's not even about what the oral history is telling so much of what it's describing, right? It doesn't really matter if my aunt was actually beautiful or not, it's irrelevant.
Mm.
Factually, truth doesn't matter, right? So, how does a poem tell the truth? Like, so much poem is nonfiction, but, you know, so many poems are. So how does a poem describe the truth? How do we know? Does it matter? Does the details matter? It's not that, right? It's describing our experience. So, like, oral history is really the history of experience, That's what they're telling us about,
mm-hmm.
right? And I think that's what you're opening up that space to, in a way. You have so much, I love that you have a space for artists, because so much of what I think we do as oral historians is really invite people to curate our lives for us, right? That's really what it is. You know, and much like a poem does, not like prose, not like in 1965 and then in 1967 and in 19, no one tells a story that way. They're sort of curating an experience, moving from association to association in this way. We are like curators, much like you, right? Nope, that's enough for now.
And I mean, I think our problem maybe that each of us has with objectivity is that it's really about power and to not acknowledge that there is power inscribed in all these relationships would be a problem. So it's like, how do we wrestle with that? And to your question, I feel it's a very delicate balance that each of us has to tread, because there are all of these wounded intimacies, these traumas, or maybe nothing happened, right? But I think the question is, once we open that up, are we gonna be there to pick up the pieces? Are we gonna still be there? Or not. So what does it mean to kind of dredge up these wounds and to play around with that? And are we extracting it for publishing, for our own sense of a career, or is it something deeper and more invested in terms of being in a community and forming these relationships that are ongoing? You know, and I think we're all balancing that in different ways.
Just wanna uplift what both of you said.
Said it great.
Yeah, can you say your name? And
sure, yeah. I'm Yvonne Long Wong. As an academic myself,
oops.
But historian who's trying to branch out into like working with live people and not just documents, a lot of what you say really is poignant to me. I've been trying to do interviews and the like, but I also want to say for like academics in the future, it's not all hellish. Like, I do feel that I'm very privileged in what I've been, I just got lucky, but I'm sort of allowed to do all sorts of methodologies. So I can go talk to some old folks in a very free-form way, but then also hit the archives in a sort of de rigueur manner. And as far, I do teach in Canada, so this is a caveat, but as far as I'm aware, no one is sort of breathing down my neck to be objective. I think historians are actually pretty skeptical of that. And this is like a disciplinary thing on the researcher's end too, I feel, right? It's like, what kind of oral history are you allowed to do? How are you allowed to tell your story? How much of yourself or your hand are you allowed to show? Does often fracture along these very disciplinary lines. So it's really intriguing to hear local scientists, people who identify along these different disciplines speak of a similar experience, which is kind of just listening to people tell their stories and then retelling their stories or curating their stories into one sort of narrative. So, yeah, thank you very much for that interesting comments.
Someone sitting down there.
Alina?
Hi. Thank you so much for speaking. So I think when I think about how necessary arts are for me personally, and also like to hear stories and storytelling, how important that is for me. I also wanted to think about, or like to bring up the idea that there are issues that are tied to the projects that you do. So when you like mentioned indigenous struggles that maybe don't center Chinese diaspora, but were still present
displacement, things like that. So I wonder if maybe through specific experiences you've had or reflection you've had, what the relationship between affecting those issues or even troubling the way that we think about those issues has to do with oral histories and storytelling.
I mean, much of this project that I'm working on is really to complicate how we think about gentrification. I think it's really ironic that so much has been written about the topic almost every day in the media, but we still know so little about how people on the ground experience it in their everyday lives and how that experience shapes their politics, right? So that's sort of the work that I'm trying to do in terms of really complicating the narrative around gentrification, and that, yes, it's a housing struggle, right? Those most directly impacted are low-income tenants, often seniors, women, single mothers, and their children. But also, there is the role of people like May, who are small business owners, small property owners. How do we insert their narratives into this picture of gentrification that is happening in Chinatown, right? How do we really complicate this conversation around displacement? And I think through the oral histories, in terms of what I found, one of the most revealing things is that displacement that's happening here is not happening in a vacuum. You know, people who are experiencing displacement, often elders, have experienced displacement multiple times in their lives, over and over again. So this is nothing new. It's really an extension of their past experiences with movement, with constant, constant movement. And how do we, I mean, that's something that oral history really does shed light on, that a lot of the ways that in which people talk and experience displacement now in Chinatown is connected to their past experiences. And so I think that's something that has been really revealing to me, and I don't think that's possible without using oral history and really conversations and relationship building as sort of a method.
Alina, can you say your question again?
The relationship that oral history and storytelling has to the issues that are either addressed or are the reasons maybe even why you reached out to people to hear their stories and record them in the first place.
Yeah. Okay. So I would say, so like the same thing that I shared about me being tired of talking about like monoracial Chinese people for all those reasons, I shared like when I was in Australia, like with people I was meeting, and I was at an open mic that was titled something, it was titled like Aboriginal Resistance, and it was like amplifying the storytelling, poetry, and creative work of Aboriginal Indigenous folks in Sydney, which is Gadigal lands, which I learned in like my first week there because of like people's movement work. And the curator of the open mic like heard what I was saying, and she was like, well, those two things don't have to be separate. There are Chinese Aboriginal people like in our community who sometimes just identify as Aboriginal. And that was a revelation to me because I think like those Chinese Aboriginal people don't live in Chinatown, and they're not the visible Chinese people that I see every day just like walking throughout the city, because Sydney has so many like Chinese immigrants like from China, monoracial. So that happened like towards the end of my trip in Australia, and if I had more time there and like more resources to travel throughout the country, I could have delved into that more. But I was still able to use that as a starting point to think entirely differently about my time in Australia and how I could think about my work. So after that, like she recommended a few Chinese Aboriginal folks I could contact, and one of them happened to be an artist, artist organizer named Jason Wing, who did an art installation in Chinatown, bringing in motifs from both Chinese and Aboriginal cultures. And so like I sat with him and I talked to him largely about just like the Indigenous history of Australia and like sort of what it means to be Chinese Aboriginal, but Yeah, just like starting to uncover all of that, right? And I didn't have time to look as much into it, and I like just left Australia after, but I'm sure there's work out there by Chinese Aboriginal folks just like hidden somewhere. And there's all of these like histories there that I just don't know about.
Yeah, claro. I just have a question on, thank you so much for everything you all are saying. It's so inspiring and very thought-provoking. A question on perhaps certain roadblocks that came throughout any of your processes that stand out, where you really gleaned something about the practice of oral history as it continues to evolve, and there are, you know, many practices, both in the academic oral history as well as arts-based oral history. You know, I was particularly struck by some of the considerations you all had about, you know, the ethics and transparency of the practice, right? Or at least it's a way of documenting history that leans towards a more ethical and transparent way of documenting history, but also balancing that with, you know, a project's goal, and with a, like a people-centered approach to documenting history. So yeah, I guess the question, going back to this idea of, was there like a particular, maybe roadblock isn't the right frame, but something that, you know, going through this project, something that you're coming away with it that, you know, shed some more light on sort of your practice of oral history.
Yes, the one that stands out right away is the lesson, which I guess in hindsight I should have known, that not everyone can interview anyone, right? There's some stories you just are not going to get permission to hear, and that's it, and you're just not the right choice for that. Sometimes you can anticipate when that's going to be true, but you can't always, right? It's sometimes not until you get in the room do you realize. Is that actually funny enough? It was my project about, it's like other eyes name you, right? So I, as for example, in Trinidad, I thought I'm a Trinidadian person. I'm born and raised here, and I went to meet this one woman who was Indian Trinidadian, and that was a big no, right? You know, it just wasn't going to be that story. I got a very guarded story, and it was very clear that she did not see me as an insider, right? And I hadn't anticipated that, right? Really, because I had interviewed other Indian Trinidadian folks, but like this was a certain generation, and it was just a no. So that sort of that has been the one thing that has come up at different times, not even just in this project, but in other ones. Sometimes I'm surprised when I am an insider, right? Sometimes that also happens. And I mean, it happens for all different kinds of reasons: ethnicity, race, gender, all kinds of stuff, age, right? But that's not a very real thing. You definitely do know when that has happened, though, so you can, you know, yeah, that's the one that stands out.
I mean, I guess the thing is, like, all of this is so unruly, and we're continuing to grapple with it, so I really appreciate that question. And it actually makes me think about interviewing my great aunt. So she was Afro-Chinese, born in Jamaica, was taken as a baby to be raised in Hong Kong. She actually ended up becoming a picture bride, and married a Chinese Indonesian man and had a whole family in Suriname. And I'll actually be going to Suriname next week, and meeting family that's there. But it was in Toronto, of course, right, that we actually met and made these kind of connections for the family. And I guess something that stuck with me in terms of interviewing her was that I have my agenda. I have my questions about, you know, did you experience racism growing up in 1930s Hong Kong, you know, being black? And she said that there wasn't any racism. And that's something that's really stuck with me in my research, and I'm still not sure what to do with that. Because my expectation was that, well, yeah, there's going to be this sense of anti-blackness. But even upon thinking about her answer, it still doesn't completely, you know, coming back to this question of objectivity, say much, but it also speaks volumes, again, in terms of this absence and silence of what she maybe didn't want to talk about, or maybe she didn't experience racism. But having done research myself in China last year, I, for the first time in my life, was called the N-word in China. And it was a really, I guess, significant moment in terms of grappling with what it means for me to walk through Shanghai in, say, 2017, and to have that be the first time that this was put onto me by someone who is Chinese, and just the way that I felt in that space that people were staring at me as though I was some sort of an alien. And it really made me think about, well, then what are the stakes of what my great aunt was saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that there was no racism. Could that have been true? And I still don't know what to do with that, in fact.
So to address the part you asked about roadblocks, I would say that this is sort of like a question that I had for other people too, like who are all of the people behind your projects who just like don't get recognition in the final thing, right? Because you're like your name is on it, because like for me that's so important, and I've never seen that transparency acknowledged, like what Nissa shared about, like, I call my mom, like, at the lowest of the lows. I think about that a lot, and, like, how these projects could really be supported by community, like, during those roadblocks, or, like, how even, like, the writing of the work, if, like, I did all of this, like, 3 months ago, and, like, I still can't write about it, like, why is that? And, like, who do I have to talk to figure that out? Because it's not just, like, oh, I'm lazy, or like I can't get to this deadline. I'm just like, it's like not related to you writing this content out. That I think about in terms of roadblocks. Yeah.
I think we have time for two more questions.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Steven. And my question is just for the panelists that have been to these Chinatowns and visited different Chinatowns and captured oral history. Did you see any striking like parallels or differences in the way that the diaspora has been manifested or expressed or captured in different hemispheres and different regions?
Well, I would say the shop is so important.
Mm-hmm.
So being in the space of a shop is so significant, and having been in Chinatown, just thinking about commerce and how complicated that is, and the kind of intimacies and tensions of that in Kingston as well as in Havana is so significant, and is what ties Havana's Chinatown to New York, and that people fled after the revolution in 1959 because of this sort of association with capitalism and being associated with the US as opposed to a kind of communist or socialist democratic project. So it's been interesting to think about, for me, the kind of shop counter as a partition, but also a space of encounter, and that's something that I guess I've noticed across different Chinatowns.
So for me and my work, I've done oral histories in this Chinatown, in San Francisco, and in Boston. And recently, in a collaboration with May, we were able to visit also Vancouver, Seattle, LA Chinatowns, and San Francisco. And I mean, the reality is that Chinatowns are changing. And that's not to say that change is bad, but the kind of changes that we're seeing today are the result of state-sanctioned policies that fuel gentrification. And it's happening in Chinatowns across the country, right? It's a global phenomenon. And I think what's more interesting and what's apparent throughout all the Chinatowns is how people are responding and how people are resisting. I think there is the narrative that people are pushed out of their homes without